that we work with are like, you know, large IT services company, mid-size, and also small startups or startup companies also. So in case if you have any training requirements, you can always feel free to reach us out. So we have our speaker, Mr. Harshil Sawant. So I will ask him to take over from here. So maybe with a quick introduction of yours, you can, you know, kickstart the session, sir. Over to you, Mr. Harshil.
Thanks, Naveen. I'll share my screen. Is the recording on?
Recording is not on. I'll just start the recording.
Just confirm once you see
we can see your screen, and also the recording has started. So okay. Basically, the recordings also will be shared to all the participants who have joined the session. Yes, sir, you can take over the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. My name is Harshil, and I'll be talking about certain things related to ROI today. Have about more than two decades of experience. Initial decade was more into technology research. I was an academician, I was a professor and head of a research center then. And since 2011, I went to a corporate world heading the learning function for mostly engineering and R&D organization, product tech organization. My research I did in IIM on learning strategies, and earlier in IIT related to technology. So today's topic, maximizing the impact and how we all as HR fraternity, HR colleagues can prove the ROI to the business for the efforts you are putting in. So that's the topic. I will take another 40 minutes to talk about some thoughts, my experience, and the model which I prepared. I'm using it for me. I'm sharing it with you. You may use it. You may further enhance it. Let's connect on LinkedIn. And if you have any thoughts to share with me, LinkedIn is the best media, and then further we can connect. So my LinkedIn details are also on the screen. So quick question. You see this image, and in the chat, please enter what comes to your mind, one word, and we take half a minute. And because I can't see the chat window, let me try if I can see chat. I can't, and Naveen or Vinod can help me if people have started entering that word. Vinod, would you help me? Because I have this type of interaction later also. Vinod?
Yes, they're chatting now. Yes.
Yeah. What comes to your mind? And let me see if I can see the chat. So will this come in chat or Q&A? Okay. Oh, I see. Oh, super. So good noon, value for money, value add food, mad happy food, junk food, different opportunities, create curiosity. Absolutely. I think you all have written. I was anticipating someone writing typically what we associate this burger with. Who provides this burger? I mean, when it comes to our mind, this giant burger, what comes to our mind? Can you put that in the chat? Which company? MacD, Burger King, Subway? Well, there are fans from all different providers. MacD, absolutely. Okay. Thank you very much. And you can KFC, good. KFC has started, I didn't know. There's a Big Mac picture, and like many of you have told, one word comes to our mind with this yellow background, the Big Mac is MacD. And I stopped this for some time, like you have mentioned, many of you, junk food, fat food, and all that. I stopped, but then earlier I used to eat MacD a lot. And my favorite example, a MacD burger. I also use MacD as a case study in many of leadership sessions. This is from somewhere in US, but then something similar, you would have seen it in the city where you are residing. The MACD outlet has got something similar set up. I'll just quickly play this video, and you may, if you find
so
you're not able
to
hear properly,
you have a minuscule revenue.
We know I think there is a problem with the video, right?
And
what volume?
Charles, of a contract that requires you to go.
Can you hear?
Yes, sir. We can hear. Yes.
Or shall I play from? So just tell me if this is okay.
So to summarize, you have a minuscule revenue stream. No cash reserves, and an albatross of a contract that requires you to go through a slow approval process to enact changes, if they're approved at all, which they never are. Am I missing anything?
That about sums it up.
Tell me about the land.
The land.
The land, the buildings, how that whole aspect of it works.
Oh, pretty simple, really. Franchisee finds a piece of land he likes, gets a lease, usually 20 years, takes out a construction loan. Throws up a building and off he goes.
So the operator selects the site.
Yeah.
He picks the property.
Right.
You provide the training, the system, the operational know-how, and he is responsible for the rest.
Is there a problem?
A big one. You don't seem to realize what business you're in. You're not in the burger business. You're in the real estate business.
Sorry, there was a problem with this sound of the video, but there's a shot, there's a clip from a movie named The Founder, and there's a conversation about the founder, this person, Ray Kroc, identifying that this is not a burger business, but a real estate business. Fantastic movie. And if you would like to know more about what McDonald's is more about and much beyond the burger, you can find out. Those who have watched this movie can appreciate what I'm talking. There's a movie named The Founder. There are many case studies on MACD, Ray Kroc, and related business. Please do listen to a lot of podcasts, movie, watch movie, or case studies. Fantastic. I'll also run one quick 1 minute video.
McDonald's is one of the most recognizable food brands in the world. And I was super excited as a kid to get that Happy Meal toy. Truthfully, I still am. But I was surprised to learn that the burgers and PDPD fries aren't actually how they make majority of their money. If we take into consideration how much money they make, McDonald's is first and foremost a real estate company. Now, Burger King and KFC earn most of their money through their products like burgers and fries. But McDonald's earns through massive holdings of land that they franchise. Nearly 85% of its restaurants are owned by someone who is simply renting McDonald's name and brand. According to a report from Wealth Management, McDonald's owns more than 50% of the land and 80% of the buildings throughout its chains. In 2019, it collected $7.5 billion in rent from franchisees, about one-third of its yearly revenue. In fact, its total value of all its properties and equipment was to the tune of $39 billion in 2019. This is a genius move.
The reason I am running this as a case to open up my talk is to sensitize you all that though McDonald's, when we love this burger, we love those ads, eat it, or if you are like very health conscious, at least you must have seen your kids trying for it, asking for it. What comes to our mind is McDonald's is in the business of burger and the quick food, but actually their core strategy is real estate. They own the property and then they lease it to those who run the business. And you can see the tune of business they earn. So there's a famous book and there's an article, what business are you in? And there's a question I'm asking you all. So you all in your current profession, HR, L&D folks, what business are you in? Again, I would request you all to quickly put whatever comes to your mind, 2-3 words, put that in the Teams chat. What business are you in as L&D professional? So while people are entering it, I'm just answering one of the questions. Sagar asked what this video is about and related to topic. I'm just trying to connect about a business, what perceives and what really is. There's a lot of case studies about we many a times don't realize what real business we are doing, and we get in flow with what the general notion is. So I just wanted to connect it. I'll connect those dots going forward. It will get clear. Business improving, knowledge skills, boiler manufacturing. So you all have written, there's a mix, retail, L&D, core knowledge enablement, SAP consulting, and then a lot of comments. Thank you. And I'll just come back. So thanks for entering those business you're in. And here is my take. So we are all HR, OD, L&D folks here on this call. We are as a HR folks, HR professionals. I believe, and I have experienced it, and thus I'm telling that we are in the business of enabling business. So many of you have written in the chat, retail and you know boiler and many actual businesses, but we as a professional, we are in the business of enabling the actual business, the company. To make that business team, whichever whomever we deal with, to make those achieve their business objective. So I strongly say that we as professionals are in the business of enabling the business to make the business teams achieve their business objectives. Just give me a minute. So like I said, we are in the business of enabling the business, and what we have to always strive for is to make business teams achieve their business objectives. So the real task for us as L&D, HR, OD professionals is to discover the true business, what it means for L&D. Let's look at some of the things. I would like to start with my own experience, and then I'll touch upon the model which we have created, which I'm using it. The true reason or the realization happened for me sometime in 2011. Earlier to that, 2001 to 2010, almost like 10 years, I was in virtual reality, AI technology, hands-on architect, consultant. I was an academician, I was a professor and head of research center, Coventry University, UK's India center I was working with. In Q1 2011, I joined HCL Technology Engineering and R&D Services, and I was a head of their academy. Earlier, HCL had an academy for IT and IT services, leadership, behavioral, and they hired me to start a technology-focused, engineering and R&D-focused academy. And I will pick up a case from there. That was my beginning of the corporate era. As earlier, I was involved with corporates as a consultant, but now in 2011 onwards, I was on the other side of the table. So I just picked up what used to happen in the company and the way L&D departments and L&D heads used to do the things. In the similar fashion, in Q4 2011, I presented a plan and a budget for freshers training. For the entire engineering and R&D, there are a huge number of freshers which HCL used to hire. And for 2012 batch in Q4, because the budgets gets prepared then, I did this presentation to the business head. This image is not me and my SBU head. I just generated on Adobe Firefly. So the discussion went on as follows. SBU head was also new. Hari, his name. He had also recently joined HCL. And he asked me a lot of questions like any other business head asked. And you must have already started thinking, it sounds very familiar. All the business head asked similar questions. So I presented the proposal and I was asked following questions. What is the real cost? Why should business take this cost? Is the training really required? Is it going to help the business? Is it going to help me in getting my targets? What's the ROI? Typical questions. I couldn't answer well. Realizing that I was absolutely dumbstruck then. I couldn't give convincing answer. And looking at that conversation, he spent some time. He did a coaching conversation, not in just one session. It took some more sessions, but then that really helped me set my fundamentals right. And I would like to share all that with you all in the session. So coaching, what he did, he clarified a lot of things. He clarified what's the true meaning of ROI, how to calculate it, and various aspects, actual calculations, we did it. And that really set the foundation for my future. And that really helped me to progress in my career as a L&D head, a consultant. And right now I'm just doing a lot of things to help business grow in Visteon. So some of the things happened as follows in that discussion. He said in 2012, for him, one of the business objective was to increase the profit margin of his business. Now imagine almost like 1/6 of the entire HCL. That's the kind of business he was heading. And the target for him as a business head was increase the profit margin by 10%. For him, the options were, I mean, there were many, I'll just summarize it. To get more business, very simple, not so easy. You know, it's such a cutthroat competition. Cut the cost. Already, you know, HCL being HCL, big large company, all the measures were already applied to cut the cost to the corners. So not much use. And then he said that, you know, if we have to really crack this, getting more margin, we need to invest very smart way and find out smart ways to really get the things done. And that really started changing my perspective. He actually did a session with me of, you know, brought the Excel sheet, brought all the, you know, metrics, and he actually showed the calculation. He showed per unit. So in this case, unit is fresher. So per unit, that is per fresher, what's the revenue, what's the cost, what's the investment we can do, and did some simulations and actually use of actual data calculations to prove certain points. That was mind-blowing. Changed my entire perspective that how the entire dynamics change, whereas as a typical L&D people, we go with a budget, you know, emotionally telling that we have to do training because it will help employees, it will help manager, all such type of talks, to purely number game. And that changed my perspective. How it resulted is as follows. The training goal became as follows. Evolve and invest in the training, which will decrease the average days to bill per fresher. So in services companies, freshers are hired, they are given training, and after the training, they are not immediately put on the build project. They are in the shadow. So the time we hire, the time we finish the training, since then, they start billing. That's a time called as average days to bill. And the target was changed as reduce it by 10%. And that was treated as a return on investment. Believe me, this became my KPA. This became our academy's goal also. I could barely manage crossing 6% by end of the year, but that itself was tremendous, tremendous increase and tremendous improvement in the profit margin. I cannot share those numbers, neither I remember now, but then those days it was amazing. It resulted in investment. What I had asked, it actually doubled because earlier it had gone in the budget as a cost, but now it was looked upon as an investment. The business revenue through freshers increased multifold. How did it impact? It impacted as follows. This all happened in 2012. That resulted in 2013. SPU provided me amazing investment. The academy team grew, the spend grew, the budget grew. So my team, which was just 2-member team, became 5-6 members team. So that's how the academy grew and business started benefiting. They were satisfied. Academy was satisfied. And obviously me too. That's again, Firefly photo I generated. So overall, this is where I'm just trying to connect. And someone asked me a question, why I started with McDonald's and then connecting. So my connect is like this. It's a fantastic case study worldwide taught in many B schools where, you know, typically like when we talk about McDonald's, what comes to mind is burger. And we think that McDonald's earn by selling burgers, but actually they earn by leasing. They are a real estate company. They own the properties, they lease it to the one who runs and then earn multiple, you know, big billion revenue. Their burger cash flow, the burger revenue is not as compared to, is less compared to the real estate. So that I'm just connecting it by telling you that typically what it sees is we are in the business of training and, you know, providing training, but actually we should find out the true things as we are enabling business to hit their own KPIs. So by doing that, we are actually enabling them, and that is our real business. So What we should always look out for is what should be the ROI which will hit the targets of the business. So let's talk about this. So with these lessons, I built my own maturity model. And like I said, I did my research in IM and learning strategies was my area of work. And I tried experimenting on different things. And what I proposed, what I prepared, and which I'm going to share with you is what I, was my research topic. My research topic related to learning strategies was something else. But then this was also a byproduct. I'll share that. I actually practiced it in HCL. Then 5 years I spent in, initial 5 years in HCL, then later 5 years in Cape Gemini, and now in Cape Gemini Altran, and now in Vistion. I'm actually applying it. It is really helping me. It's helping me win the trust from business, getting a lot of investment. Now I'm consulting mode, helping our HR teams to crack this game. So APT model I'll talk about, and ROI parameters I'll talk about. But before I get onto the model, I will start with a few examples. You all must be very familiar with it. So I'll just quickly touch upon. And those examples are to put on my model to explain you. So before I start those, starting with this first example, here it goes.
Welcome back to the Gap. How those assorted tank tops work out for you?
Right. So those who have seen this movie, Minority Report, I picked up this clip from that report. The reason I'm using this clips is because there's a pedagogy and it's being promoted by Harvard. And I am a big user, big fan of this is movie as a media in our learning courses. Just wanted to tell you, you can really make use of movies. Not that everybody watches, but then there's a good message available. And in the longer session, like a day or two, a movie can be used as a media to really convey a right message. So coming back to our session, so Minority Report is from where I picked this up. And this movie, believe me, was based on a novel set in 1956. So a novel which was written in 1956, depicting the scene in 2054. That novel was picked up by the producer and the director, and I think Steven Spielberg. And this movie was produced and released in 22. So almost like a 100-year span, and sometime in the beginning of the century, this movie was showcasing what the future would be in 2054. Believe me, those days, AI, hyper-personalization, hyper-technology, hyper-automation wasn't there. It was only the talks in science journals and some fictions, but then this was depicted. And believe me, this is actually taking place. And I'm damn sure not even 2054, easily by 2045, 2040, we would actually get this realization done. Already things have started changing. So I worked, like I told, I worked in AI during my early days in around 2000 to 2010. I was hands-on on AI, virtual reality, and I since then realized how things are shaping up. So with that, I'm telling with the confidence that by 2040, we would have hyper-personalization done as what you see in this movie. So there are these terminologies, if you have not heard, get yourself familiar because we are entering into all this era soon. And as an L&D professional, as an HR, OD professionals, we have to get acquainted with all these terminologies because that's how things are changing. That's how our new workforce is getting into all this, new generation is, a mobile generation. They have everything on their mobile. They are very well conversant with ChatGPT, everything. They do it with high automation. So hyper-personalization, hyper-automation, hyper-technology, I call it as, APT model, A for automation, P personalization, T technology. And I'll use these terminologies in my next few slides. So this was a movie showcased the applications in marketing and ad arena, but then same thing would come definitely in HR L&D also. So hyper automation personalization technology, APT, that's the acronym I'll use in following slides. And there are multiple applications. There are already case studies available. Some of them have already tried. During my research days till 2010, I did work with hyper automation, hyper technology. We used virtual surgery, and I have a clip to show you how it was used. And that's a dual purpose. It was as a trainer module as well as a module for hospitals. So let's look at this. So far I talked about future. Let's go back to past and then again pick it up till today. So first example, just remember those who were in that era working. If you remember 2000, it was a year Y2K problem. And then people were really wondering what will happen when the clock turns 2000, year 2000. Lots and lots of training happened those days. No automation, no personalization, no technology. It was a mass scale training program on Y2K, COBOL programming. There's a clip from my lab, and this person, his name is Brian, and he was working on virtual surgery. That's a real data of a human we picked up from our hospital, NSR hospital, and that was experimented. It was a module for a training as well as for a research.
It's okay.
No automation, no personalization, very high-end technology. Another example, 2012, the earlier one was 2007. In 2012, this I did in HCL where we did something called as a modular certification, and engineers had multiple jobs, multiple competencies, multiple modulars, and then like a university, pick and choose, create your own credit courses, and then build your curriculum. This was experimented, mass scale, low automation, no personalization, low technology was used, and the objective was achieved. So the objective was met through a business ROI, the way I explained. But if you see how much investment was done on three different directions, you can see this through APT model. There's another example, again, did in HCL 2015. This is a kind of program you all must have done it. Typical residential program for leaders. Outbound training programs. What do? There's no automation involved. It's highly manual. Little personalization depending on the batch size. Absolutely no technology used. But then we still achieve the objective, that ROI. This is in 2020. So what I've done is every 5 years I've picked up one of the case just to give an example of how things have evolved. And it's not only with me. I think all of you must have gone through the same phase and a similar style. It was a time when we hit the we got into a pandemic, and that really taught us how to conduct webinars. Now we are very conversant and doing the webinar now. But imagine those days we were doing classroom primarily. Webinars were very new. And that was a time when we realized that, the future is going to be more automated, more technology based. We did, when I was in Capgemini and running the academy, did a whole lot of webinars, almost like over 3.5 months of those pandemic, almost ran 50 different topics for, the engineering services. No automation, no personalization, low technology, very simple Microsoft Teams was used then. But then done it at scale, like 10,000 people attending it. And 10,000 people were the scope. At any given time webinar, we used to have around 300, 400 people. And that was a time where the realization of APT happened, and I really got excited about how we can use this APT. I then built the model, which I'll just talk about now. So this is a model. I prepared it as part of my research, my own practitioner research, practice, and experience. So there are these three dimensions, I believe, in technology, personalization, and automation, with the scale of no or manual or generalized to low, then mid, then high, and then hyper. So there can be no technology to hyper technology. There can be no intervention to highly personalization. And then there can be very low or no technology to hyper. There can be no automation to hyper automation. So if I believe that there's a three-dimensional model, and any program we do can fit into this model. For example, the virtual surgery I explained, it was a low automation. Again, what means low may not be same for others. In my company, in my purview, in my capacity, it was low. For someone else, it may be high automation, right? So the maturity model, I call this as a maturity model. Maturity models are typically based on the ability, the capability of the business, capability of the academy team or the HR team. So this is my model, and not necessarily being copied as is, can be modified and used. But if I give an example, virtual surgery was low automation, no personalization, but high tech. The experimental OPL was kind of mid personalization. It was no technology, no automation. So that's a model. And I believe this gives an idea about how to place our learning intervention or HR or OD intervention, and then plan how much should we invest in. And with this as an approach, when we reach out to the business, really we talk the language of business, because business people like to hear business talks, right? What matters a lot is ROI, and balancing in this model, I believe truly depends on the ROI, and what different ROI parameters we should use is as follows. So if you remember, and those who have worked with balanced scorecard, we have four perspectives, financial perspective, growth perspective, customer perspective, and process perspective. On the similar lines is what I have made my model. What you see is one of the perspective, financial. Now, if we put up our ROI, picking up any of the financial metrics which business is following, and then present the business that, hey, here is your metric, and I'm aligning to that metric, capturing your ROI, and to get that 6% or whatever percent increase, I would need X percent of investment. So when you put up that as a calculation, the chances of listening by the business is very, very high. There would be a lot of trust. They will appreciate that we are following the business talk. The buy-in will be much higher. So you pick up any of this sub-metrics. For example, top-line improvement. And I give an example of profit, which business was trying to achieve. And then through the freshers training, by reducing days to bill, we actually helped business achieving their metrics, right? Brand. Some of the companies, like in our company also, one of the parameters in the past company, rather, if I say in Cape Gemini Ultra, brand, one of the measure was a Glassdoor rating. And that was taken as one of the parameter to see how the brand is, especially from the employee branding point of view. Now, through certain OD initiatives, can we take that as a measure? So today's Glassdoor rating is X. And by doing some intervention over the year, can we see an improvement in the Glassdoor rating by, let's say, 10.1%? Or whatever is a target being set. It can be a board or MBO, management by objective. It can be a board KPIs. It can be a competition. It can be any metrics which business is following. We can pick up a small portion of it, bundle it with our training or HR OD initiative, and present it, get the investment, run it, and then we show the real ROI. It can be a bottom line saving. It can be an optimization. It can be quality or productivity related metrics. So first time right and on cost delivery, these two were very highly rated metrics, highly considered metrics in business when I was in HCL. And then in Altron, I saw on time delivery also added. But typically in engineering R&D services or any services, first time right, whatever workers are doing, what our engineers are doing, are they doing it first time right? Are they on the cost and delivering it? Are they delivering it on the time? These three were very strict measures of the work being delivered. Now, if we can pick that up, and whatever intervention we do it, be it OD intervention or be it L&D intervention, and track the metric and show that there is a significant improvement in first time right. Say, for example, if you run a training program on technical aspects, and by doing it, people perfect their ways of doing, right? And because of that, the quality department is measuring first time right metric, that is improved. That can be used as a case to prove your ROI. I had actually done it, and really it had worked. There are compliance standards in current place in Visteon. We are audited by IATF, International Automotive Task Force. And there are those standards is one of the thing which I have picked up in Visteon interventions related to competency assessment. So that's my measure, and we are tracking closely. A business is happy because that's a very high standard. IATF, if we don't comply, we don't get business. So if we are proving those metrics through intervention, why will not the business fund us and invest in me, invest in us and trust us? So that's what actually I'm doing it and I'm sharing with you. Value creation, actually one of my KPA in HCL was CSAT rating. So the KPA for Academy and so as me was how much. So in CSAT customer satisfaction report, there was one section where customer was rating HCL on the competencies of people. And it was I think 10 point rating, 10 or 7 point rating. And then the target for Academy was to improve year on year 10% in customer satisfaction index. Simple, right? So some of the ROIs, some of the metrics can be used at the program level. Some of the metrics can be used at project level. You can do so. So there can be, you know, any kind of metric you take it, either business or from the department, and then connect it with what your proposals are. So what I mean by ROI is just go beyond our KP, Kirkpatrick model. Kirkpatrick model, we typically do reaction, then the knowledge or skill gain, and then the, you know, delayed feedback or on the job improvement. And the fourth level of Kirkpatrick is ROI. And we keep wondering, oh, how will I do ROI? I don't have the numbers. And probably ROI can be only used. So there's a myth telling that, you know, ROI can be done fourth level only in the sales training because that's where we can see the improvement in sales. It's not so. I believe any intervention, HR, OD, L&D, any intervention, we can actually do a Kirkpatrick level 4 ROI using any of these metrics. It can be also a patents filed over the period. It can be about the new features. Like currently I'm working in the product company and I'm tracking through one of the program how many new features an engineer is bringing on the table and how much overall as a product we are enhancing our features. So there's a very deep intervention happening, a program called as Ignite, where we are tracking how much differentiator engineers are bringing on the table. So whatever I'm showing are actually being practiced. Anyone who needs more detail, any kind of guidance, please ping me on LinkedIn and I'll be very happy to help you. At the same time, you have to be very cognizant about constraints. So though I'm presenting a lot of things, does not mean that it can be immediately and easily being implemented. You need to also look at the company culture, the constraints, the urgency you have or the importance on certain aspects, and obviously the maturity of the HR team or L&D team or OD team and the maturity of the organization. It requires a lot of eco support as well. The business also has to support. And there's a long way to go. Not that overnight we can start implementing all these. I'll not take time because we have another only 3 minutes left and we need to have some time for Q&A. This is example 6. Now I just would like to talk about how I am currently applying this ROI metrics. So there's a program which I'm running in the sense now currently in my present role, I'm a consultant to HR teams and part of talent management, individual contributor consultant, and I'm guiding the L&D and HR team on this. But overall strategy is as follows. So there's a program which we are running, very high-end program, very high investment program, but investments are not happening in any automation. Investments are not happening in any technology, but then it is highly personalized. It's very specifically designed. And what are we trying to achieve? What is my ROI parameter here? I have picked up these two dimensions, value creation and innovation. What's highlighted in yellow is what actually being tracked as a part of ROI calculation towards this program. So I'm looking at some talent metrics. I'm looking at organizational learning metrics, knowledge management metrics, and career growth metrics, which are anyways tracked as a talent management and HR team as a part of our annual goals, annual KPIs. At the business point of view, we have picked up how many new features we are bringing in our product. So Visteon, as a company, we are in automotive electronics, and almost like 80% of the cars on the roads, what you see, have got clusters or IVA or either or something related from Visteon. Like when you drive a car, what you see in front is a clusters, those displays and meters and the infotainment system. We are the manufacturers of it. So how new features are brought by our engineers, design teams, product teams is one of the metric we are capturing. how much differentiators we are bringing and what things we are bringing in the market. So these are being tracked at the larger level by business, and we would like to, we have built a causality of the training and interventions in some interventions like this Ignite with respect to this features differentiator. So that model of causality relationship is built, and this is how we are proving to business that interventions are actually getting paid off. Again, another example, again, not spend much time, but then there's a long run, which I started 2023 when I joined, for 2026 is a long run program, which I have built it up. Earlier, there was no automation, and this is with respect to competency assessment, development, planning, and actions. Like I told, IATF is an audit we face, and I use that as one of the driving force to get the business approvals, use that as a metric apart from what I'm just showing. But if I have to just quickly narrate about this program, earlier in 2023, the program did not have much automation, no personalization, no technology, wherein through a phase-wise approach, we are moving it towards high automation, mid-personalization, mid-level personalization, mid-level technology intervention to get the ROI metrics achieved. For example, what are we trying to achieve? We are trying to achieve first-time right score, on-cost delivery score, on-time delivery score, significant growth through that. Long-term intervention, primarily complying with the standards and the IATF audits and standards. We are also trying to achieve some of the KPIs of talent management team. What I'm trying to tell you is, it is possible to build the causality having through proper relationship model, use a proper maturity, put a ROI calculation, put it to the business, and business understands business language, all these types of terms, most likely you will get through. And once the trust is built, there would be much benefits and the freedom given to HR and L&D folks. And that's my reminder. Thank you. So that's it from my side. So in conclusion, I would like to say, this is what the session we started with. Can we maximize the impact of all of us? We are all HR, OD, L&D fraternity. So can we maximize our impact of our efforts? And like I mentioned, yes, sky's the limit. We just have to open up our mind, think from the business point of view. What really matters is striking the right balance in the model, whatever model you follow. Need not be this APT model what I am. You can have your own maturity model, but find the right balance and consider the ROI. You can have your own maturity model. You can use any dimension. I use it because it was in my ecosystem, but definitely use the ROI parameters. And once you build it, sensibly apply it. Little hastiness may ruin the entire setup, and then you may lose the trust. So you need to be a little careful about whatever you set it up. So with this, I close my talk. We open up for Q&A. And let's see if there are any questions you have. You may please use Q&A window to ask your questions. We'll see. This is a webinar, Teams webinar. So the questions have started coming in, and right. So Shivaji has asked, sir, can you please provide more details about quality and productivity metrics in which you said you have implemented? I will just once again talk about it. So I'm taking an example of service company in HCL. Now there's a little different metrics, but then in service company, then I'll say if I take the example of HCL, first time right. There's a quality department, and every project being delivered, these are being captured by quality assurance team, QA team. And they see whether the delivery which is done to the customer was right at the first time, or was it submitted and customer referred it back and then corrected and submitted it again. In this case, it's not first time. First time right is whatever is asked is delivered to the complete satisfaction of the customer. So there is a number which is given by the quality audit team, quality assurance team. Now that number is captured by the quality team on the quality portal. Now, if that can be tracked, that can be used over the long duration, that can be a method that can be a measure to say that we did a training program, and because of this training program, the score on FTR, first time right, has improved. And what kind of training program? See, we always talk about in HR, L&D, you know, behavioral aspect, the ownership. Let's say one of the behaviors, ownership. Now, if engineers start taking more ownership, make it their strong point, make it their passion. If they start believing that what they are doing is their own stuff, and they are doing for their own pride. If we can inculcate that kind of, you know, feeling through a training program, will it not result into their first time right score? It will. There are proven research which shows that it is, right? So you need to pick up a right metric which has got causality. This is called as a causality. Because of the training program, there is a chance of improvement in first time right delivery. There's a causality, right? There's a research required, but there are some proven metrics, proven researches also, and you can pick it up. Likewise, on cost delivery, and these are some of the metrics anyways tracked by quality. As an L&D or HR, you really don't have to worry. You just have to pick up some of the metrics being captured by some of the business systems. Make use of it to prove your point. I hope that would answer. What are the most common challenges organizations face when attempting to measure the ROI of L&D and HR programs? Like I mentioned, typically, and my own example, earlier days, let's say when I joined, I didn't know. I typically had gone to the business side telling that I would like to do this training program like last year and many other businesses are doing. Freshers training, 6 weeks training, there's an external vendor, blah, blah, blah. And then here is a cost towards it. The next question came is, okay, what's the actual cost? Then we say, okay, that's a direct cost, indirect cost of infrastructure, indirect cost of people from our company, you know, working on it, etc. Right? So when we otherwise talk, we talk from our shoes as a L&D. And that's the major challenge what I believe we face as HR. If we talk from their point of view, if you have done design thinking approach, and design thinking generally I did, I'm a design thinking certified. I also was an adjunct professor to Department of Design, Coventry University, and actually apply that in my regular practice. So design thinking says that empathize with the end user. Now, in your case, in our case, HR, L&D, our customer is a business. Now, let's empathize with the business and what business thinks and they want to think and they want to achieve. If we think from their shoes, right, we will get an answer. So a business head says that, hey, CEO has given me a target of reducing the cost of, you know, material cost by 10%. Now, that's a pain point the business has. And if we go and talk that, hey, I'll do this training and that training, he's not going to buy. So the challenge, I believe, is we should not talk in, though we should do the work what HR fundamentals and L&D fundamentals are says, but when we talk to the business, we should talk in their terms. They talk cost reduction, they talk percentage, they talk top line, bottom line, these metrics, talk in their language, and I think the problem will be solved. So the challenge is, you know, we staying in our own shoes, that's a challenge. So next question, I want to know any other model you suggest other than Kirkpatrick for measuring ROI. There are multiple models. I never used it. Some people have abolished Kirkpatrick and simply use NPS model, Net Promoter Score. But then I believe Net Promoter Score is more perception. It's a perception. So if you run a Net Promoter Score survey today, those engineers, and then imagine what are the different things which we do it. We do a nice town hall, we do a annual gala, and immediately after that run one satisfaction survey, scores will be good, right? It depends upon the mood, and that's where I say NPS or any kind of things are typically a perception. It really doesn't give the metric. What business I have, my experience last 15 years in corporate, people, business heads don't appreciate all this perception-based metrics, right? So any other model, I have used Kirkpatrick, I have used NPS, but other than that, I typically use the fourth level of Kirkpatrick using the metrics which I showed. The next question, also, how did you convince business that A training leads to B? That requires some data analytics and some causality fact. It's like some previous data you take, build some causality. Causality is like those who are not familiar, typically those who do a research, we take certain set of data. So there is a A and then there is a B set of data. And then we say that there is a relationship between A and B and, you know, in simple regression. So B improves or decreases when A increases or decreases, some kind of causality, right? You need to make use of a data crunching, some kind of regression analysis. If you do that, definitely 101% business will appreciate because they will see what their language is. So you just pick up a head of marketing or head of research or delivery. They will have their metrics and they do have their own regression models. Everyone has got their PMO team and who does analytics. So if you do in the similar fashion, why will they not listen? So how do I convince my business? I do a data analytics. I do present some kind of causality model, which I build it. The question continues, as there can be any linear relationship between training intervention, improvement of top line? Definitely yes. We can build that relationship and model. It's just that someone has to really put that effort and find out. Another question, can you please share more formulas, statistical sheet tools, more metrics and evaluating in numbers, which can be used for our daily life? I right now don't have, but then there are tons available on internet. The reason I used in one of my slide Firefly image is not just to bring that. I wanted to tell all my HR colleagues and those who are already using, I'm very happy for you all, but those who are not, AI has advanced to a really great extent and really, really easy to use, very, very friendly. I use ChatGPT, so I use all the GPT models, ChatGPT model, Google, now Brads has changed, and I also use Copilot. And then I have also built my own customized model in ChatGPT. I use a lot, I use Firefly, and all this not for any training intervention, it is purely for analytics and strategies. But wanted to tell you that a lot is available. We can easily get a lot of things right out there. Please don't misuse or please don't think that ChatGPT will, ChatGPT is a generator. Any Gen AI is a generator. It is not your research tool. So for research tool, there are some other applications. But what I'm trying to tell you is today's internet age, you just have to ask right to get your stuff. So the question, can you please share formulas, statistical sheet? You just search for things and you will easily find. Maybe just ping me with a very specific question. There's very generic, so I couldn't answer, but you will definitely find it. And one of the slides I talked about a book, and many of the pictures I used in my slides are from either HBR articles or LinkedIn, some of the good authors' articles. There is a whole lot of available in HBR also. Next question, is there any effective way to measure ROI for behavioral soft skills program? I told you that, for example, let's say you are running a program for communication skills, and you just have to find out. One thing I would like to recommend here, you don't have to pick up or you should not pick up a metric which you cannot capture. There's a very famous book called as Measure What Matters, right? So first, you should measure what matters for you. Secondly, you should have mechanism to measure. So for example, if in the company, you don't have a quality department who is measuring the first time right or on cost delivery, then you should never open your mouth and tell about this, because then it will come to your head and for which you don't have any mechanism. So find out in your company what metrics are measured by different business teams, marketing team or quality team or manufacturing team or R&D team or whatever team. If they're already measuring it, see that they're regularly measuring, they're honestly measuring, pick that up, find out, is there any relationship? So for example, if you are in a BPO setup and your customer satisfaction rating has a is being measured in the BPO, and if you run a communication skills program, it is no-brainer that there is a direct relationship between communication skills training and your customer satisfaction of a BPO call center employee. And it's a very no-brainer causality. Use that metric and prove that there is an improvement. The risk you carry is if the improvement doesn't happen, business will shoot you. And that case, you'll have to really look upon the quality of the program. So it is a double-edged sword. Once you pick up the business metric to prove your ROI, you are on that edge to really improve, really look upon the quality, because then you are actually proving the business, the metric which they believe in. So that's the answer. Any effective way to measure ROI for behavioral business, like I gave an example of accountability, you can link it any behavioral program with a proper metric if you are carrying. Otherwise, should be really looking for how to build that metric. Are there any specific tools or software platforms you recommend for tracking, reporting ROI in HR? I don't recommend directly. If your business is already having, please use that. Building a ROI tool exclusively for HR L&D, difficult, very difficult to manage. We need some data analytics and some people who already measure it. But then otherwise, nowadays, what I understand is new age LMS and HRIS platforms, and I won't use their names, not to market anyone, neither I can recommend because I've never experienced, but I've heard in conferences that new age tools which are AI enabled, if they're linked with the business systems and like ERP platforms, they can bring in that ROI which you can use it. In my company currently, what I'm doing is we have Microsoft BI tool, which is our central tool where we feed in data from business, from Jira, from my cornerstone LMS, and then we crunch it there to see the correlation between two datas, right? So I use BI of Microsoft Teams. We are on the top of our, it's 4 o'clock. So I will just stop my thing, but just last question, BI, Microsoft BI is what I use, but then there are many other toolkits available. You just have to have a data analyst bringing multiple set of data from different systems of business and your HR or LMS data to crunch it to get the ROI calculation. So I think with this, I will just close. Though there are some more questions coming in, please ping me anytime or drop an email to SkillUpRight team, Naveen, Vinod, and I think that will be good and we would be very happy to help you. It's my pleasure, talking about the area which I'm really passionate about. These are all my research areas, practiced, and it's kind of passion for me. Thanks, Naveen, Vinod, for inviting me to talk about the area which I really loved. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks, sir. We have a feedback link also. We are leaving it on a chat, so if you can fill up the feedback form, it'll be helpful. And thank you so much, Harshal, for your insightful session today. Especially, I like your expertise on the APT model, that is automation, personalization, and technology, and also sharing all the best practices that you have implemented in the organization that you have worked. So it's truly been inspiring and valuable to all of us. We deeply appreciate your time and effort in sharing your knowledge. Thank you once again, sir, for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Thank you, everyone, for participation and asking those questions and insightful queries. Help me also to think. Thank you very much. Bye. Have a good day ahead. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, sir. Thanks, everyone, for joining in. Have a nice evening. Bye-bye.